Good evening. Good evening, everybody. Good evening also to the ones that come after the reception dinner. If I may have your attention, everybody. It's a great pleasure to welcome you all to this exciting event, PechaKucha at the Fram Center. As we like to point out, Arctic Frontiers is contributing to knowledge-based development in and of the Arctic. And one of the key focus areas on this year's conference is the ocean. Most of the Arctic is covered by ocean, and we need to increase our knowledge to be able to make use of it and take care of it. It's immensely important for the future, both as a resource and as a fragile ecosystem. We know more about the surface of the moon than we do about our oceans. There's nothing better than to invite both conference participants and the rest of Tromsø to a popular science event about the Arctic Ocean. And tonight, scientists are making their research more accessible in short and concise presentations, filling the gaps in our knowledge. So please welcome my good leader and leader of my good colleague, I'm sorry, and well, my good leader tonight.
I just got a promotion.
Maria Vartresia, take it away.
Thank you very much, Ola. Thank you. What a great pleasure to see so many people here tonight. I mean, this is a huge crowd. But don't be shy, you can come a little bit closer to the stage. There is a lot of space in front here. And I am very excited because we have a great set of presentations covering a wide scope of topics all connected to the Arctic Ocean. We have 12 talented, engaged, and skilled speakers all ready to both educate and entertain us. And we will even get a Northern Lights show at the end of the presentation. And by the way, the expert, Paul Brekke, who will be giving us the Northern Lights presentation, he asked me to particularly let you know that this evening the forecast says that there will be a Northern Lights, very visible. So on your way home from here, look up at the skies and perhaps you will see a beautiful natural show. So, I am super excited and I hope all of you are as well. And I think that we should just get started. I will then introduce our first presenter. Our first speaker comes from the Netherlands and she has lived by the ocean for her whole life. With her presentation, Anna will tell us about what our dinner had for lunch. And I'm very curious, Anna. Please, come to the stage, take it away. Give her a hand, folks.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome. My name is Anne. I'm studying in the Westfjords of Iceland, and I'm presenting here my master thesis research. As you might have guessed, I would like to talk about plastics. In the past year, the attention and the interest for plastic problem has increased a lot. It even had more Google searches than climate change. Pictures like this albatross are what caught my attention at the beginning of setting out to find a thesis topic. It's not just sad, it's also a waste of resources. And for this, I also... so far, we have not done our job to actually protect our environment. As soon as I knew I wanted to work on the plastic problem, I also looked into what would be beneficial to the Icelandic community. Iceland is a fishing nation, and they do like their fresh fish, but also rotten Greenland shark delicacies. And for the fisheries, one third of the Iceland's GDP is actually supported by this. When I looked around, however, little was known about the plastic occurrence in Icelandic waters, which led to my research question of what the plastic occurrence is in Icelandic cod and saithe from the west of Iceland. In the study, I also wanted to use a method where the guts are digested with a chemical, potassium hydroxide. It's also used in the production of soap. And the digestion method I wanted to compare to a method where you scrape the guts, empty it into a sieve and rinse it. It's a more simplistic method. I wanted to see if there was a difference in the plastic occurrence between the two species, cod and saithe, but also if the length and weight of the fish and other biological factors played a role in the plastic occurrence. This was all done in a generally equipped laboratory in Iceland and in cooperation with the Marine Research Institute and the Norwegian Institute for Water Research. The scraping and sieving method is pretty basic. You take the guts, the scrape out the inside of the stomach and the intestines and put it into a sieve. Then you rinse it all with a lot of water and take a look to see if there is anything interesting going on there. You put it in a petri dish and look under the microscope to have a closer look. The digestion method is a bit different. You take the guts and put it into a big jar. Then you add the chemical solution. In this case, it was KOH, the potassium hydroxide. You put it into the oven overnight, and then afterwards you filtrate it and look at the filters with the stereo microscope. As you can see with the graphs, the cod, the percentage of cod and saithe that contained plastics was actually fairly high. Just imagine that about 1 in 5 of the fish snacks that we ate here at the conference would have had plastics as lunch. It's also high if you compare it to some of the other studies in the North Atlantic, where they only found 3% of the cod containing plastics. Statistically, there were no differences between the two species, and neither did any of the biological factors I tested show a relation to the plastic occurrence. I also put the plastics into different categories, like fibers and fragments, and then also didn't see a significant difference in the plastic occurrence per category with any of the biological factors like length and weight, or how full the guts were with food, for example. The plastic seems to be randomly distributed among the fish I analyzed. It went all smoothly, more or less, and it was summer holidays, which is actually good because the lab was deserted most of the times. Good for me because it meant less interference with air contamination, with fibers, but also good for the people in the building because you can imagine that digesting guts is not necessarily a very pleasant smell. And for the manual dissection, I didn't get enough results to actually compare it to the digestion method quantitatively, but looking at the ease of use, I would say that with the digestion of the guts, you have a higher chance of actually capturing the very small microplastic particles. So much to do. Okay. Oh yeah, if you use the digestion method, it is more expensive and you need to have laboratory experience. So it might not be the best option all the time, but if you think about using a digestion method, you actually should keep in mind that it is one of the least expensive options available. I hope that with the research, I supported the Icelandic community and that I filled a small part of the knowledge regarding plastics in the ocean in Icelandic waters, and it might serve as a stepping stone for further research, but also increase the interest. Even though I put my energy and effort into this research, it's not necessarily the most important part, I think, of solving the plastic problem. We already know quite a lot about where we find it and how it moves around the ocean. With regards to research, I would say personally that it's more important to look at the effects and impacts at this point. So what are the effects of having plastics in your guts? Or what about communities living with problems with waste management and large ecological ecosystem impacts, and also social and economic costs? As for the solutions, I think that the efforts have to be put towards preventing plastics to enter the ocean, taking them out of the rivers and removing them from sewage water, but also getting rid of the use of single-use plastics. We don't need them. And also, we should start cleaning up everything that we already put there. In the past year, I have met a lot of nice and interesting people from different countries and different organizations, and most of them actually say that, yeah, they do show a concern about the plastic problem, but they also say sometimes that there are bigger problems to focus on than the plastic one. So you can't solve all the world's problems, so I chose the plastic one, and I can't do everything by myself, so I hope that everybody here, in their own way, help the world a tiny bit, and then together, we can solve this problem. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Fantastic. Jumping from fish guts over to a very different topic. Our next speaker is the creator of Threshold, a podcast and public radio show which takes deep dives into complicated environmental issues. Please give a hand to Amy Martin and welcome her to the stage to hold her presentation. Please.
What comes to mind when you hear the word Arctic? I've asked a lot of people this question, and the first answer I usually hear is ice, cold, snow, polar bears, but almost no one mentions Arctic people. We know the Greenland ice sheet is melting, we know the sea ice is in decline, but what do those changes mean for the people who live in the Arctic? I wanted to find out, so I went to all 8 Arctic countries, reporting for my podcast, trying to learn about this region through the eyes of the people who live there. And tonight I'm going to give 2 short glimpses into some of the stories I reported on, starting with Shishmaref, Alaska. This is Walter Nyakpuk. He was 10 years old when I met him in the summer of 2017, and he lives in Shishmaref, which is a town of about 600 people way up in northwest Alaska. There's a church, a school, 2 stores, and about 150 houses. And everywhere you go in Shishmaref, you can hear the roar of the ocean. This island is only about 0.5 kilometer wide, and it's getting smaller. This is another Shishmaref resident, Nora Kuzaguk. She was 70 years old when we met, and she raised 10 children here. Her first language was Inupiaq, and she told me she had memories of visiting people in who still lived in traditional sod houses when she was a child. She also remembers having her hands slapped with a ruler if she spoke her native language at school. Shishmaref has become something of a poster child for climate change in the Arctic because this island is going through an erosion process put on steroids by climate change. Basically, the ocean is eating Shishmaref. The community used to be protected by a barrier of sea ice in the winter, but now that ice is forming later and later, leaving the island unprotected from violent Arctic storms. And at the same time, the permafrost is thawing, which accelerates the erosion. The people of Shishmaref have voted 3 times to relocate their village to the mainland, but they need about $180 million to make the move. And so far, they've had a really hard time getting their needs heard in Washington. About 30 other coastal communities in Alaska are in similar situations. A lot of people ask, why is this town located in such an dangerous spot? And unfortunately, sometimes the question comes out like this, according to many people I spoke with on Shishmaref. Why do these dumb Eskimos build their community on a barrier island? But that kind of question and that kind of thinking demonstrates ignorance of the history here. Inupiaq people were traditionally semi-nomadic. Movement was one of their key survival skills. There was no permanent settlement on this island until the early 1900s, when the Lutheran Church and the U.S. government arrived. And at that time, the Inupiaq were told that if they didn't send their children to the new school, the government might take their kids away. That's why this community ended up located in such a dangerous place. So why are the people of Shishmaref at risk? Is it because of climate change or colonization? And I think the answer is clearly both. In short, there is not only one inconvenient truth about climate change or about the Arctic, there are several inconvenient truths, and they're all interconnected. Krista Sanook, pictured here, is a teacher in Shishmaref, and she told me, quote, "We're talking about climate erosion, eroding away the land. Well, it happens to people's cultures, too." And this intersection between climate change and colonization is happening in every country in the Arctic, including here in Norway. This is Sara Katrina Alexandersen. She's in high school, and she and her family are Sami reindeer herders on the island of Kvalia, right here next to Tromsø. And climate change is making reindeer herding much harder for the Sami. The warmer temperatures mean the reindeer's winter food is often covered by a layer of ice, so now the Alexandersens and many other Sami families have to feed their reindeer throughout the winter, which is a big added expense. But at the same time, the Alexandersens are being threatened by a possible climate change solution. A new wind farm is going in on this island. It's called Project Nordlicht, and when it's complete, it'll have 67 turbines, making it one of the largest onshore wind energy projects in Europe. And that might sound good, but it's going in right on top of their reindeer herding grounds. As with Shishmaref, the reason why the Alexandersen family ended up herding their reindeer in this one spot on the coast has a lot to do with colonization. The Sami homeland was chopped up into the countries of Norway, Sweden, Finland, and Russia, making it next to impossible for reindeer herding families to use their traditional migration routes. And now designated reindeer herding areas are very scarce and very precious, but unfortunately outsiders still often think of them as empty spaces on the map that are ripe for exploitation. Sarah Katrina, the daughter, asked me, what is better, many reindeers or hundreds of wind turbines? And I think the deeper question she's pointing to is, why do we have to choose? Why are we pitting an indigenous, traditional, low-carbon lifestyle against a renewable energy project? Isn't there a better way to meet our climate goals? The Alexandersons are very worried about climate change, and they want to find a solution, but they're asking the world to think about how we solve climate change. Because they say, if the solutions to climate change only come from within the same worldview that created this problem, we are bound to perpetuate the injustices against the Inupiat, the Sami, and many other groups around the world. The theme for this conference is Smart Arctic, and to me, one of the smartest things all of us could do right now is to open up to other ways of relating to our planet and to each other. And as part of that, we might begin to seek out Arctic people and try to learn from them. They know more about protecting our northern oceans and northern lands than anyone. What might happen if instead of forcing indigenous people to adopt the economies, languages, and even the climate change solutions of outsiders, the world paused for a minute and listened to what they had to say? We're on the cusp of an era of massive climate change disruption, and it's very scary. But is it possible that we could use this climate crisis as an opportunity to right historic wrongs and set a new course for our collective future? As old systems are overturned, could we build new ones with power distributed more equally and more space for a variety of worldviews to connect and cross-pollinate with each other? These are some of the questions we're going to continue exploring on Threshold in coming years. Thank you so much to Maria for the invitation to speak to you tonight, and thanks to all of you for listening.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Amy. Marine litter is a huge environmental problem. It's threatening our oceans. And the next speaker is a researcher in marine resource management with great knowledge about particularly the Barents Sea. Please welcome Jannike Falk Andersson to the stage for her presentation on dumping of marine litter.
So, preventing litter entering the sea is the most cost-effective measure against marine littering. But then we need to know who are littering. And today, I'm going to introduce to you some myths about the sources of marine litter in the Arctic part of Norway. Myth number one. The litter we see up here is due to long-range transport from the south. Some claim that the Asians have to stop litter in order for the Arctic to be clean. So it's transported up here with the currents. Myth number two, land-based and sea-based, fisheries-based sources are equally important to the litter that we find on the shores. So this means that we both have to look at land-based solutions and solutions at sea to solve the problem. And myth number three, fisheries-related litter is due to accidents. We have really rough seas up here, and things can get lost during operations. And we've explored these myths through a methodology that we developed and called Beach Litter Deep Dives. And in these deep dives, we involve experts to help us look at the litter and say, well, can we tell something more about the sources of the litter? And can we say something about why does this end up at sea? So what does this involve? It involves being in beautiful Arctic nature, but also to be in field work where you are hit by sleet that is coming from the sky, you are going through smelly mountains of waste, and you're calling up complete strangers saying, could I please have a look at your litter? But most importantly, this is cooperation with the stakeholders. So we are working with Norwegian, Russian, and Icelandic fishers, and they are the ones who have told us about what we find on the coastline. And as an example, they told us that when you find a piece of net like this, the hole in the middle tells that there's been a damage to a trawl, and that this has been cut out to be replaced by a new one. And then it has ended up in the ocean instead of being disposed of properly. So why are we concerned of nets? Well, they make up quite a large portion of the litter that we find in these areas. And they are a danger for wildlife that get entangled and might suffer and die as a result. And through analysis using experts and collaborating with researchers around the world, we have found that 90% of the litter, or these cutoffs, are from Norwegian and Russian fishing vessels, or a type that is used by Norwegian and Russian fishing vessels, and they are discarded. Furthermore, we started looking at the nationality of the household bottles that we find along the shores. And what we found is that there seems to be a strong overlap between the nationality of the household bottles and the nationality of the fishery going on in this region. So Norwegian household bottles, Russian household bottles, and also we got information from fishers that are cleaning the coast of Finnmark that ever since the Eastern European fleet got access to the Barents Sea, they see household litter from these nations. We also looked closer at industry litter, which is today said that, oh, this is from industry, from land. But then the fishers said, well, these kind of oil and chemical containers, they are used on board vessels. So again, another item that can be linked to the activities on at the sea. And this is packaging bans. When something goes wrong with the packaging machines on board the trawler, this is what happens. And this machine belongs under deck, so when you find this pile on the shores, it means that someone has brought it out of the boat, and someone has discarded this. This is another thing that is discarded from onboard processing. We have communicated with those cleaning up at Svalbard, they find them, and this is what is actually on these rolls of plastics. It's sheeting that's used, again, for onboard processing of fish. So if both find the plastic sheets and the rolls that these are on, again, indicating dumping. But some things are obviously also lost. There is a component of this. We find a lot of floaters, and this might be where we could reuse some of the litter. And also we know from fishers that they don't want to lose gear because this is costing them money to replace it. So this is how we have to look for solutions. Another thing we looked into are ropes, and we also could trace this back to the fisheries. To the left, you see pieces of rope that are cut off after the fishers have repaired their nets, and somehow this ends up at sea. And we don't know how easy it is to prevent this, but as you can see from the picture in the back here, it adds up all these small and large cut-offs. They add up to a lot, and they add up to a lot of the number of items that we find along the beaches. So if you can change this behavior somehow, then you can do a lot of, then you can reduce the amount of litter. So, myth number one, we established that the litter that we find up here is mostly from local activities and sea-based activities. Myth number two, a larger proportion of this litter is probably local compared to or from this ocean and not from the land. And then also the third myth that I've now forgotten because my slide is gone, but it's also a myth and not a truth about the litter in the area. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Jannike. The show rolls on, and our next speaker is going to focus on green investments and whether this can be a solution to protect the vulnerable Arctic ecosystems. Well, I'm very curious about this. And without further introduction, I would like to welcome Adrian Brown coming up on the stage and tell us about climate bonds. Please give him a hand. Okay.
Good evening. Good evening. I would like to share an idea with you today evening, an idea based on my work and on my experiences. But first, I would like to draw the line to today's evening's topic and the whole Arctic Frontiers Conference, so the Arctic ecosystems and the Arctic Ocean, and the question, how do we protect, how do we take care of the Arctic Ocean and the Arctic ecosystems? So what do we need for that? So we need very good project planning, very good ideas, but we need also people. We need people that show commitment, motivation, that have knowledge, the willingness to do something. But even though everything of this is in place, people that show commitment, motivation, knowledge, so smart people, and also great project planning, one crucial thing is missing that helps us to bring our nice, very good project ideas from our desks, from our computer screens, into real life, into implementation. And this thing, well, it's not a big secret. Actually, every one of us comes to with this across quite often. It's a question, how do we raise the capital to finance our great ideas, our great projects? So where do we get the funding from? How do we solve the money issue? And, well, I live now for 5 years in Rovaniemi in Finnish Lapland, in the Arctic Circle, working as a researcher and entrepreneur. But before I came to Finland, I worked in the finance sector in Central Europe, more precisely working with corporate governance issues. And there I came across for the first time with this idea and issue of socially and environmentally responsible investments, or they're often referred as green investments. So investments, so capital is allocated to follow a green purpose, to something that benefits the environment or not could benefit the societies. And and in the last couple of years and recently I worked with these issues, and I'm interested how this green investment, how green financial products could be utilized so that capital could be allocated to the Arctic, to the regions, not European Arctic, Norway, Sweden, but the entire Arctic, and so to follow green purposes and also for to promote societies in the Arctic. And one financial product I came across with, and that is very popular, is are the so-called green bonds. These are debt securities, so that so they could be traded and issued on stock exchanges. And investors from all over the globe on the big capital markets in London, Singapore, New York, Frankfurt, they just and everywhere else, they can just issue bonds, but they can also buy bonds. And they can trade them. And to make things a bit less abstract and more practical, I would like to give you an example. So as we are in Norway right now, let's assume that, just a fictional example, but let's assume that the regions of Troms and Finnmark, that they have a great project idea on the desk to tackle the issue of plastic waste and littering in the Arctic Ocean. So they would have the idea, what they need is that to construct 4 vessels, 4 high technology ships with, let's say, an investment of, let's say, 200 million euros or 2 billion Norwegian krona. And but and everything is there, so there's good planning, there are people who would do that, but of course how to raise this capital. So the regional budgets, they are perhaps already allocated, that's for the next year's not possible. Then could reach out to Oslo, to the government, they just say no. Perhaps the idea, maybe Sweden or Finland, they could work together, maybe a joint project, but they say, no, we do not have a shoreline with the Arctic Ocean, so we give it a pass. But what could they do to finance a project like this with a high sum, with high investment needed? They could issue a green bond. So they could, for example, in Luxembourg and Oslo and Helsinki on the stock exchange, and investors all over the globe, they could buy and share whatever they want. They could buy these bonds until this 200 million euros, 2 billion Norwegian krona, are raised. So they just could give it a maturity date, a time span of 20, 30 years, interest rates to give incentives for the investors to invest into these issues and then to buy these bonds. And that's a way, it's just one example, how capital could be raised in the Arctic to follow these green purposes or societal purposes. And well, it is quite going on already in China, in United States, There are quite large sums of green bonds are already issued, but here in the European Arctic and in the Arctic overall, there's still not that much attention to that. And so, and I put emphasis on these issues, and I'm interested in how this is developed further so that people maybe not only just take a look into state funding or other funding opportunities, but they could, that they perceive this possibility to reach out to the capital markets. And I'm interested also to what extent, for example, particularly the Barents region communities work together. This perspective, I mean, we have in the Nordic countries, in Norway and Sweden, a couple of good examples how capital has been raised already for example, for green housing or for energy efficient solutions. That is often linked to this issue of tackling or the climate change issues. So that is, so these solutions to mitigate or adapt to negative impact of climate change. And the city of Gothenburg in Sweden is one example. They have done over the past 15 years quite many quite many projects, and they have financed this by the issuing of green bonds. And I'm working with this issue, and if you're interested to learn more about that, please feel free to contact me. My name is Adrian Brown, and I will give also tomorrow a presentation in the Future of Arctic Governance session at Arctic Frontiers conference. And thank you to the organizers, and it was my pleasure to talk to you today evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah. Good job. Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Miss Zoe Walker, and she comes from Canada, and she wants to tell us a story about herring and whale abundance in Kolfjorden. So please just take it away.
So my name is Zoe. I've just finished my master's degree in coastal and marine management and Arctic marine systems ecology. But I'm not really going to tell you a proper structured overview of my research, but instead about a very scary story that happened to a friend of a friend of mine in a fjord just outside of here. So her name is Harriet, or was Harriet. She's part of the Norwegian Spring Spawning School of Herring. And her and her friends had just returned from the luscious open ocean to their wintering grounds in northern Norway. Ancient herring wisdom had told them that Kolfjord was the place to be in the winter of 2012. She was swimming along peacefully one day, and out of the darkness rose a single pearly bubble, then two, then many, then she was surrounded. Panic broke out. All the herring, they were racing, swimming to the surface. She couldn't get away. She didn't know what was happening. And then all of a sudden, the bubbles turned to jaws. There was at least five enormous pairs of jaws surrounding her. She was terrified. Right next to her appeared a huge wall of baleen. Nasty, smelly hairs, dead herring stuck in them, still gasping for help, some of them. All of a sudden, it was over. As fast as it had happened, there was calm. The water cleared, and the picture became even clearer. Herring swam around, looking for their friends, their family, their loved ones, so many of them missing. She wondered, how many herring does one whale even eat in a winter, at a time? She didn't know. She thought that she was safe, and she looked around her, and her eye caught the bottom. What she once thought was rocks, she could now see was very clearly dead herring, her dead friends. She was wondering, how have you gotten there? How many of you are there? She was terrified, confused. She looked up to find comfort in her friends, but instead, coming right at her, a torpedo. Big, shiny teeth darting in her direction. She was sure this was it. This was the end times for Harriet. Just at the last second, the teeth veered to the side and an enormous orca showed its side. She thought she'd escaped, but smack, the tail hit the water around her. She was stunned, paralyzed. It all went dark, and she came back to consciousness. She wasn't sure if it was seconds, minutes, or a lifetime later, but she started to swim. Slowly at first, and then with purpose. Why was she here? She was hungry. Weren't they all hungry? Isn't that why they'd come to the fjord? So she started to swim with serious purpose, but there was nothing, Just inky darkness, crystal clear water, not even algae, nothing. She was sure this wasn't right. Every once in a while, she happened across the path of a tasty little zooplankton. Delicious. She was sure there had been more of them. It was the middle of winter, the days were very dark. She estimated that there was about 102 individual zooplankton per cubic meter. Not very many. In the middle of November, when she'd showed up, there was at least 4,503. The situation was bleak. She looked back down to the seafloor. She saw the benthic community struggling, fallen herring everywhere. What impact was this having? Would they make it through? Was this her fault? Was this her fate? Would she die? She didn't know. This is a serious story. It got worse. She didn't die then. Maybe she does. She was swimming, and it became hard to breathe. What more terrible things could happen? She remembered the lush environment with 90% oxygen saturation. Now, down as low as 30%. It was the brink of existence. Out of the darkness, she swam into a grungy net and came face to upside down face with hundreds of dead Atlantic salmon. She was terrified. She was sure this was it. What had happened? Who had put these in a pen? Why were these fish in a net? Was it a zoo? Was she supposed to enjoy this? She had no idea. She decided this was enough. She was making a break for it. The days were getting longer. There was significant light in the horizon. So she made a break for it. She swam back to the coast, the open ocean. There would definitely be oxygen and maybe even a snack. She was joined by so many of her friends. She felt comforted. They were all going the same direction. That was before she realized that there was a tiny bit of terror in their eyes. She stopped to observe the situation, and she heard in the distance a deep metallic rumble. This wasn't the whales that she'd been escaping all winter. This was something else. Something terrifying. They were racing now. They were going as fast as they could, trying to keep up. She didn't even have time to ask anyone what was happening, and the net closed in. She was trapped. Her and her comrades all united in their universal acceptance of death. This was it. How could they possibly escape the net? They didn't know. So they rose to the surface, Harriet trying desperately to get out of the net, but to no avail. As she crested the surface, she looked out over the alien landscape and saw so many whale-watching boats. She couldn't help but wonder if it was being managed sustainably. Then she came over the deck. She flopped onto the frosty, frozen fishing trawler. And that was it. That was the last anyone I know ever heard of Harriet the Herring. So, terrifying story. I heard this a couple of years ago and was deeply rattled by the tragic fate of Harriet and her comrades. Why did they come to Kalfjord? What were they looking for? What are they now looking for in Skjervøy? Why don't they come here? What is the ancient herring wisdom that brought them to this area? We tried really hard to figure it out. We wrote the proposals. We had it all going. We tried to decode it. Why did all of those herring and salmon have to die? We just don't know. This is where the story gets really scary. The herring and the whales, they migrated, they moved. They were too impatient for the proposals to get funding. They were too impatient for us to catch up to their rapid migratory pattern. And Harriet, I just have to ask, why? Why would you let a master's student move all the way to Tromsø, Norway, to observe the abundance of herring and whales and then rob her of that chance? But that's my own personal horror story.
Fantastic. Great. Wow. Wasn't that great? So you told me not to say it was scary, but it was a scary story. Fantastic. Thank you very much. Okay. So on to the next presentation. And our next presentation is about Zing Ocean Conservatory, which is protecting the ocean. So our next speaker is Michelle Legernes, the co-founder and vice president of Zing. And she's going to tell us all about what that is. So please come up on the stage and tell us about Zing.
All right. Hi, everybody. My name is Michelle Legernes, as Maria said. I'm from Zing Ocean Conservancy, and I'm going to tell you a little bit tonight about what we do. So first off, where does our name come from? One definition for the word zing is having to do with positivity or enthusiasm. And it also comes from our boat. In 2017, my husband Jonas and I lived in the Caribbean on our sailboat Zing. We lived very simple lives on the ocean. We had no fridge, no shower, and only the sun as our energy source. We would always be sailing, diving, free diving, fishing, spearfishing, and surfing, and it wasn't hard to see the problem. Dead and bleached coral reefs and trash everywhere. And with our lives being pretty much dependent on the ocean, we felt like we were obligated to do something and to give back to the ocean. So we started Zing Ocean Conservancy, which is an organization and a movement founded for the sole purpose of doing what we can to help the ocean with positivity and enthusiasm and to help it with zing. So here actually on the left is a picture from our very first cleanup in the Caribbean, very little. And after we started offering free rum on all of our cleanups, they got bigger and bigger, as you can see from the picture on the right. Yeah, got much better. Here are our current board members from left to right. We have Jonas Lagernes, who's a Norwegian skipper and also head of our marketing. And then me, I'm a marine ecologist. And then we have Marika Anderson, who is our political scientist. And then Josh Hausman, who is in charge of everything down in the Caribbean. So what exactly is the problem? As we all may know by now, here are just a few examples of plastic that we use every day. Most people's cars, computers, phones, you name it, that's all made out of plastic. 260 million tons of plastic is produced worldwide each year. And of this, 10% ends up in the ocean. And to break it down even more, worldwide, it is estimated that 15 tons of plastic is dumped into the ocean every minute. And of this, 95%, about 95% sinks to the ocean floor, 4% stays in the ocean currents, and about 1% makes it to beaches. That's what we see. We decided to take Zing across the Atlantic from the Caribbean to the Mediterranean, visiting several continents along the way. And we were assessing cultural norms, trash management, and marine education as we went. They were very different on every place that we landed, but we saw trash everywhere, marine debris, and we even saw it in the middle of the Atlantic. Here's a picture from Morocco, where tourism is out of control, and the marine environment was obviously very, very, very trashed. We actually went here to spearfish, and then ended up just picking trash instead. So unfortunately, right before we sailed back, two Category 5 hurricanes hit the Caribbean, leaving us without our home or our jobs. So we were forced to move out for a while. We decided to come up to Norway, where Jonas is from, and we met our now project manager, Marika, along the way. We brought Zing Ocean Conservancy up to northern Norway, up to Tromsø, and we started collaborating with local boat tourism companies. Here, with the help of Milio Directorate, we started the Arctic Cleanup Coalition. And here's Marika being super cool, carrying a lot of trash on one of our first Norwegian cleanups. For this year-long project, we are going out every month with a new boat tourism company, cleaning remote islands around Tromsø. Since June, we have cleaned over 5 tons of trash, with a goal of 12 tons by the end of the project. Now, you may be asking yourself, with 15 tons entering the ocean every minute, how exactly are we making a difference? Well, these cleanups are not just to clean up. We take partners and volunteers out to show them how big this marine pollution issue is. And even in northern Norway, we are picking up 1 ton of trash on average every 5 hours, with less than 12 people. And we are finding trash both from other countries, like Janneke was saying, and from Norway itself. With the help of these boat companies, we also provide a vessel for other organizations to do research on the trash that we find. And we can find out where the items have come from and how they even got into the ocean in the first place. And this brings me to the ultimate goal of Zing Ocean Conservancy. And that goal is to teach others how to reduce the amount of plastic entering the ocean by promoting sustainable practices, both with consumerism and with waste management. And we do this through education on board and through marketing via our social media. And what else do we like to do? Well, we love to be out with animals in the wild, and we love to be out in nature. With every cleanup we do, we realize more and more as the plastic pollution problem increases worldwide, the fewer encounters we will be able to have with these amazing animals. And they are being heavily impacted by marine pollution and many other factors as well. And here are just a few examples, and we saw the albatross earlier, of animals harmed by plastic pollution worldwide. And guess what? A lot of these animals are a part of the very food chain that we are on top of. So in other words, we're probably eating the plastic that they're eating. Just a little food for thought there. But there's hope. So we're expanding our organization more and more and becoming involved with education with younger children, volunteers, paying tourists, and businesses. We plan to do this through a marine debris education platform, similar to a boat that we went on called Volcana this last year. We are working on repurposing an old fishing vessel into a place where many people from different backgrounds can come and learn about the marine environment. This year, we are also looking for a very dedicated person to come on board and help us create memberships for Zing Ocean Conservancy. So if you're interested in helping out in any way, coming out on one of our cleanups with us, coming out on one of our adventures, making a donation, just liking us on Facebook or Instagram or following us, or making a positive change in your life, that's an awesome way to support us and become more sustainable. And that's us, Zing Ocean Conservancy. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Great. I'm just going to jump right over to our next speaker. She has passion for ocean and the fjords. Dear friends, please give Silje Lundberg from Naturvernforbundet a big hand as she comes up to the stage to tell us about coral reefs and black smokers in danger. Please.
Thank you, and thank you for the invite. My name is Silje, and I'm from a town not far from here called Harstad. It takes about 3 hours with a boat. And when I grew up, I pretty much grew up by the sea. My dad always dragged me out. We went on boat trips. And every summer when we got in his car to drive somewhere, we always ended up by the ocean. And the ocean has always mesmerized me. And when we went out rowing in our rowing boats in the summer, my dad was always so afraid that some of the whales would some way just flip our boat, even the smallest ones. Because the whales that we have up here and also further south as well, they're here because of our unique ecosystem, and they're here because we have a nature that allows them. And we also have one of the world's biggest cold water reefs. It's outside of Røst in Lofoten. But our ecosystems are in danger. And just as the miners had their canaries to warn them about the danger, we have our seabirds who do the same. And our seabirds are telling us a big warning is about the changes that are coming and that our oceans are facing. When I was born in 1988, from then till now, the population of the sea parrot has gone down with 70% in just those years. Because the life in the ocean and in the Arctic is the life on the edge. But we live in the north, and we are able to live here and to work here because of our ecosystems, and especially and first and foremost because of the cod that brought the fisheries here and brought the people here. And this is my friend Yngve. He lives in Vesterålen, and he is one of them, the many who is dependent on the sea and is dependent that we continue to take care of our seas. But the seas and the oceans are facing an incredible amount of threats and danger. Many of you in this room might have heard about the big environmental debate that has been going on in Norway for a lot of years, and that is oil drilling outside of Lofoten, Vesterålen, and Senja. That is an issue I'm not going to talk about because I consider it one, and I do believe that it never will be any oil drilling outside of this area. But we can't kind of rest just because of that, and we can't say that our oceans are safe, because we see that the oil industry is continuing to pushing further and further north into more and more vulnerable areas. And as climate change is happening, as the ice is melting, new areas are opening up for oil industries to come into. And this is also an example. This is a photo from Bear Island in the north. It has a protective zone of 65 kilometers around it, and the environmental governments want to expand that to 100 kilometers to protect the vulnerable nature. But our government has instead allowed for oil drilling up until the 65-kilometer zone. And they're not stopping there. Our government is continuing to pushing further north, and now we're going to map oil and gas locations even further north in Spitsbergen. This is King Karl's land, to see if there is oil here that we can maybe someday explore for. But it's not just oil that is threatening our oceans and threatening the life that is there. This is a photo from Jan Mayen, an area that used to be plants for oil, but now those plants have been swapped from oil to mining, deep sea mining. And that is mining for minerals on the seabed. And now imagine a place in total darkness, with pressure that is as if an elephant was standing on your foot, and temperature as high as many hundred degrees. That's where you find these black chimneys or black smokers, or as they're more scientifically called, hydrothermal vents. They are spewing out minerals, and you would think that there were no life in these kind of temperatures, but that is not even close to the truth. Here is where we find the most early evidence of life, is close to these vents. And when researchers from the university in Bergen went and found these vents outside of Jan Mayen in 2015, they also discovered 50 new species that was completely unknown to man. But instead of protecting these species, instead of protecting these vents, our government now has planned to open up these areas for deep sea mining. And maybe you should be astonished by that fact, but when you see how we also have our mining industry on land, you shouldn't be astonished at all. This is a photo from Repparfjord in Finnmark, where our government has allowed for the dumping of mining waste containing copper into a fjord. A fjord that is protected as a national salmon fjord, where it's not allowed to have any salmon farms, but it's apparently okay to dump mining waste. This is something that Norway does as only one of five countries in the world, and still we boast of being an ocean nation. So this is my message to you, is that you shouldn't always listen to what the politicians say, especially if they're giving speeches in international seminars or conferences. But luckily, we have people standing up, and we have people who are opening their eyes and looking what we are about to do both to our fjords and to our oceans, and standing up and saying that this is it, that we need to protect the nature and we need to protect the ocean also for the future. Because it can't be the way it is now, that it's always going to be the money that's going to play the important part on how we develop. We need to let nature set some boundaries as well. So I'm going to close with a last picture, and that is a picture to remind us of what we're actually fighting for. This is a picture of my mom and my nephew, and I hope that my nephew will be able to go and experience the ocean as I have done, and to grow up with it as I have done, and don't have to clean up our mess after our industries and after we've earned enough money. Thank you.
Thank you, Silja. Now, on to a quite different kind of presentation, which I'm really excited about. How did I get here? That's the topic, the title of our next presentation. And Eli Kintich is a video producer and science journalist and a former staff member at Science Magazine. His talk will connect three lives over a century in Arctic exploration. So please, the stage is yours.
Dad, it's Eli. Today we are on the ice sheet in Greenland. I went with the scientists on a helicopter. It was unbelievable. to be there on the ice, this... Oh. You're back. I mean, what a dynamic world, colorful, a varied terrain, and yet while it's alien, I realized, Dad, it was also so ephemeral, you know, a place you could never return to, because even if we came back with GPS to that very spot, it would be different next year. It melts, it freezes back a little, it melts more. A place you can never return to. How did I get here on the Greenland ice sheet? Father, it's me. It's Minik. I miss you. I miss our home. I miss a manak, the ice, the light, the whales that would pass, the seals you taught me to hunt, our kayak, the way it looked in the morning. I was so little when I was on a manak with you. You were my hero. You taught me everything I knew. And then that man came, Robert Peary. He wanted to go to the North Pole. But he didn't this time. Instead, he took our meteorite, our iron. He wanted to bring it to New York, and he persuaded us to come with him. There would be warm houses and food, and he would bring us back. The newspapers called me the Eskimo of New York. But, Father, it was lonely. Soon you were sick. And then you were gone, tuberculosis. The Museum of Natural History supposedly buried you. I was there, I saw you buried, but it was a lie. They put an empty casket in the ground. They took from me what mattered most, dignity. And when I told the newspapers what had happened, Father, no one listened. It was lonely, it was hard to be alone. I was buried in New Hampshire at a young age. Is this our legacy? Is this what the Arctic means? A rock sitting in the American Museum of Natural History? Men who come and take? I miss a manak. I miss home. Dad, it's me. It's Jen. We made it. We made it to the Arctic. What an experience. The light, it's inspired me. I think I'll be a scientist, and I'll study the weather. I've always loved the weather, you know, with that sailing in the Arctic, and the temperature of the Arctic. Boring at first, this weather idea, but then the warmest, fastest warming place on the planet, Dad. Ice disappearing before our eyes, and everyone's looking at the water, but I decide to do research on the air. And it's the jet stream that I study. It's a river of air, kilometers above the surface, that creates weather and moves that weather along. But Dad, is there a link between the changing Arctic and the jet stream? And could it have global impacts? Let me explain. So on the equator, you have a thick atmosphere, the tropics, it's warm. On the poles, you have a narrow atmosphere. And so Dad, the movement of air, sort of rolling down that cliff, so to speak, towards the poles is what creates the jet stream. Because as the Earth turns, that air moves from west to east. But what happens when the Arctic gets thicker? It warms up. That gradient is reduced, and what used to be a more straight jet stream becomes curvy. And I think this is what's driving global weather. And in fact, in December of 2017, we saw this massive cold air dipping deep in that curvy jet stream into the United States. Frozen crocodiles in North Carolina, massive winter storms in the Northeast, and a bomb cyclone, like they call it, moving up the coast until a journalist from Science Magazine called me from a ship in the middle of the Arctic. His name was Eli. He wanted to know what was happening in the Arctic. Dad, it's Eli again. This time, years later, again calling you from the Arctic on the sat phone on the Helmer Hansen. We're in the ice. It's incredible. But I was talking yesterday to the scientist. She told me about the storm that's coming. She told me about the air and how it's moving, how the storm that hit the United States was hitting us, and we couldn't sleep, we couldn't work for days. Everything on the ship was moving. It was chaos. And it got me thinking about that time I called you from Greenland, this idea of the Arctic as this ephemeral place always changing that you can never return to. We go there in these massive, incredible machines. But what if the Arctic is now coming to us? What if it's not that the Arctic is ephemeral, but rather that the Arctic is inescapable? What if, Dad, the Arctic has come home? How did I get here, the middle of the Arctic Ocean? How did we get here? Thank you. I'm producing a documentary called Into the Arc, Into the Dark with Mike Snyder, who's here. If anyone wants to get involved, we're looking for sponsors to add to our team. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Eli. Our next speaker has a really cool vibe of girl power. Her name is Gosha. She's a researcher at the Arctic Center at the University of Lapland in Finland. And together with Terry Pryor, she founded last year a project called Women of the Arctic, which is really cool. And she's also an eager diver in love with the ocean. So without saying anything else, I give the stage to you. Please, thanks, take it away.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Have you ever searched for pictures of Arctic women in Google? I mean, have you put Arctic Ocean woman in Google search? If you haven't, I can tell you, you wouldn't find many. Like maybe this single one that you see now here of Icelandic fisherwoman, or this one. That was actually a movie from 1960s. Really, I didn't know about that. Now it's there. But it is actually really interesting. If we think about it, that women are almost half of Arctic population. How is it? How is it possible that we see so few of them? Where actually women are salt of this earth. Like those women here from Lofoten, that I guess many of you know. Salt of the ocean, I would say, for that matter. So in order to address this gap, to shed light on amazing women of the Arctic, last year we organized an event in Helsinki in September, Women of the Arctic, Bridging Policy Research and Lived Experience, together with University of the Arctic and hosted by University of Helsinki. We held an event where we brought together women of all 8 Arctic states, those here, those were our speakers, of indigenous and non-indigenous origins, who came to Helsinki and supported here with funding from Nordforsk to discuss issues that matter most to Arctic women, to discuss issues that they face, challenges, their successes. During the discussions we had, we spoke about role of women in Northern decision-making, in leadership, the role they play in Northern business, in scientific research, exploration, about very important, painful topic of gender-based violence that still is there. To make sure those conversations would not be a single time, that they would not stay in Helsinki, we worked with this group, with Collaborative, What Took You So Long, to document the entire event. And we also interviewed many of our speakers. And I'm very happy to say that very shortly, very soon on our website, www.genderisnotplanb.com, you will see videos from this event. And among persons for who also agreed to speak with us to be interviewed was former president of Finland, Ms. Tarja Halonen, an active spokesperson for women's rights and gender equality. So we work together to make sure that we can create a platform for telling stories of Arctic women. And to reach even further beyond academia, we also reached to New York-based art organization called Arctic Cycle. And they produced for us, they wrote for us a play called Whale Song, inspired by stories of women of Alaska. And we performed that at the start of our event. But not only, we're also joined by women who heard about our event, like this, Esther Horvath, the photographer documenting disappearing sea ice, whose work has been recently featured in the New York Times. She's working with polar scientists to raise awareness of this Arctic woman. Or like here, Caroline Landau, an artist who's been sailing around Svalbard and in northern waters, and who is a glass blower. She blows glass to archive ice and preserve its beauty before it's ultimately gone. We are also joined in the conversation by Ms. Paula Lehtomäki, the next Secretary General of the Nordic Council of Ministers and the first female to take this position in March this year. The conversations that we had during those days actually went on. And like in this picture that you see here, it was a picture from a five-hour breakfast that we had the next day. We made a booking and then we had to prolong it and then they almost kicked us out because conversations were going on. And women were exchanging contacts and sharing experiences. So based on this, we went on to, in October, to Iceland, to Arctic Circle Assembly, where we had a session on possibility of organizing the first Arctic Women Summit. The idea that got great support, we are happy to say, got great support both from the audience and from the panelists. And panelists were coming here from Iceland, Greenland. They were sharing with us experiences, among others, of Icelandic women's movement. Greenland women were speaking about their experiences. Nina Larsson, Swedish Canadian, was telling about experience of Northern women gathering that they hold. Here is, for example, a picture. We went to see leaders of Icelandic women's movement, of those who founded the Red Stockings movement, to learn how we can bring gender equality, that today Iceland is the first in the world, how we can bring it to the Arctic. And furthermore, of course, to address issues that haven't been addressed. And for this, last year, we registered Women of the Arctic as a nonprofit association in Finland. And this is our start. This website, genderisnotplanb.com, serves as a storytelling platform where soon we'll have interviews with many women. But also, you remember the first picture that I showed you of a single woman? That's our call to you. Please make us help. Please help us give a full picture of women of the Arctic. Send us pictures of women who work, live in the Arctic, engage with Arctic, to make sure that we can give it full. Because as we feel, without women of the Arctic and without gender equality for everyone, we cannot have sustainable development, neither for the Arctic nor for the ocean. So this is our plan A. Let's make gender equality plan A for the Arctic. Thank you.
Awesome. Awesome. Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, time is moving really fast, and we only have three presenters left. Our next speaker is Mr. Trevor Bell. He has twice received the Arctic Inspiration Prize for knowledge to action plans that benefit Arctic people. His most recent partnership, Smart Ice, was recognized by the United Nations for its novel climate solution. So please give him a big round of applause, and I'm excited to hear your presentation.
Okay. Thank you for sticking with it tonight. I think there's only a couple more to go. I'm here to talk to you about Smart Ice. Smart ice is a climate change adaptation tool that helps reduce the risk of dangerous sea ice conditions for Arctic communities. You probably are more familiar with hearing about news about the polar ice cap and how the sea ice in the Arctic Ocean is declining and shrinking. What I'm talking about tonight is more about the sea ice that is around Inuit communities, the ice that surrounds and where people live on for 8 to 10 months of the year. This ice is really important to Inuit. It's not just a hunting platform that feeds their family. It's not just a travel highway. It is part of their identity. It is part of their culture. And it is declining drastically. This is Andrew Ariak telling us about how important this is for his community. Climate change is a disaster for Inuit with respect to sea ice. In one warm winter in Nunatsiavut, in the eastern part of the Canadian Arctic, 1 in 12 people that year had fell through the ice. 2/3 of them are afraid to travel on their usual trails. This is genuinely a disaster for Inuit. Coupled together with a new generation that don't have the same skills as their elders had, the lack of on-land experience, that's why the number of search and rescue events doubled in the last 8 years in Nunavut. What we decided to do, our story began with two pilot communities, Nain in Nunatsiavut and Pond Inlet in Nunavut, where we developed a sea ice monitoring system, essentially integrating remote sensing, on-ice measurements, and Inuit knowledge to try and monitor ice in real time. This is a photograph of our stationary sea ice thickness sensor, which remotely measures the sea ice thickness and the snow and sends that back to the community. We also have a mobile sea ice thickness sensor, which is towed behind on a sled behind the snowmobile. And it provides the thickness of the ice in real time to the operator so that they can navigate on the ice safely. But when they return back to the community, the track where they travel shows up as a color-coded sea ice thickness map. And it allows people in the community to alter their traditional trails to be able to take account of dangerous ice conditions. Smart Ice received the Arctic Inspiration Prize in 2016, and this was a real game changer for Smart Ice, because what it meant was that we can suddenly go from having our pilot communities to spread across the Arctic to 15, 20 communities with another 12 looking to hopefully take up the sort of service for them. And what this does is, what we decided to do was to develop a social enterprise, not a typical for-profit business, but one that was more in tune with Inuit societal values. And so as we extend across the Arctic to all of these yellow dots, and hopefully the green dots become yellow dots in the next year or so, we're really interested in working with the community, and especially around their values and the idea that we can have a positive impact on the communities where we operate. That's one of our primary concerns. Some of the Inuit societal values that we're talking about are care for the community, being resourceful, being innovative. And Arctic and Canadian Inuit are incredibly resilient to change and are very innovative. We designed Smart Ice, or we co-designed it with the community wherever we operate. So here we are meeting with elders in the community who tell us how Smart Ice should operate in the community and how we should be integrating Inuit knowledge with the technology in the services that we deliver. Inuit knowledge is very important. Just like sending somebody out into a desert with a GPS, it doesn't mean they're going to survive. It's important that we think about Inuit knowledge as something that needs to be preserved along with their practices and culture. And this is something that we have, Smart Ice has promised to do, is to augment Inuit knowledge, not try to replace it. We feel it's important that Smart Ice is operated by young Inuit. Young Inuit who make up, in some of our communities, more than 60% of the population. They have the traditional knowledge, they have the skills to be able to take our technology and adapt it for their own environment. I'm often asked, how do we integrate Inuit knowledge with Western science? And I say, we don't. What we do is we take Inuit on your left here and we train them to be the scientist. So we replace the person on the right. We're also being socially innovative in having our technology assembled by Inuit youth in the north for the north. So on the right-hand side here is the first ever Northern Technology Production Center in Canada. And we'd like to expand this to other communities across the area. We need to be sustainable. We need to be able to continue this service into the future. And so one way we're doing this is looking for commercial opportunities with industries who also rely on safe sea ice for their profitability and maintenance. So we're looking at community-based fisheries, community-based tourism. All of these tourists here have paid tens of thousands of dollars to be at the ice edge, and they need to be able to travel safely on the ice. But I want to leave you with one message, and that's my hope, that the legacy of Smart Ice will in fact be to inspire Inuit youth and to harness their vast potential and for them to recognize the value of science and technology in being a vehicle for economic development and well-being in their communities. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm very excited to introduce our next speaker. He is a senior advisor at WWF Norway, a Norwegian ocean superhero, and my friend, Fredrik Myhre. So everybody, please give him a big round of applause as he comes onto the stage to tell us about his passion for ocean and what worries him about the ocean. Fredrik, please.
Thanks. Wow, what a great introduction, and I'm really honored, and I'm really honored to be here to speak to you tonight. Are you having a great time? Are you having a great time? Yeah. I'm here to bring you down, sorry. Is this a setting sun, or is it a sunrise? You be the judge after this introduction, or this short talk. We see that, looking at the broader picture of the planet, we know that we are in the middle of the sixth mass extinction that this planet has experienced, and for the first time in world history, one single species is behind this. We say that 60% of all biomass on the planet has gone in just since 1970s. How's the state of the ocean? Is that any brighter future for the ocean? Well, in the last 40 years, we see that there's almost 40% of the biomass from the ocean has gone. It's looking at the commercial fish species, 90% of them are either fully exploited or overexploited for today. Looking at the habitats, coral reefs, for instance, 75% of the known coral reefs today are under threat. We know that just 0.1% of the world living area in the ocean is coral reefs, but at the same time, 25% of all the animals in the ocean lives on these reefs. That says something about the magnitude of it. And it's not in the tropics, only in the tropics that we have coral reefs. Celia has talked about this previously tonight, but we have them in Norway as well. Over 6,000 of them, actually, in Norwegian waters. And they should all look like the ones on the up right, but 30 to 50% of all of our coral reefs that we ever had are looking like the big picture that you saw. They are destroyed, mainly due to fishing activities. And there's also other habitats that are under threat. We know that 20% of all the mangrove forest in the world has gone since 1970s. 30% of all the seabed meadows, seagrass meadows, has gone. And also in parts of Norway, we see that 80% of all the kelp forest has gone. And I don't have to talk to you too much about the sea ice. It's been quite well well described already. We see that the sea ice is going. It's nowhere on this planet that we see a rapid change as much as we do up in the north and in the south. Northern parts of the world and the southern parts of the world. And just outside this building, we also see that we have endangered animals. We see that we have cod stock. We have the biggest cod stock in the world, but at the same time, the coastal cod are doing quite bad. The coastal cod are really endangered. And at the same time, also the common redfish is one of the most endangered animals that we have in Norwegian waters. And why is the ocean important? Of course, there's wealth, there's seafood, and we see in Norway we have record year in, year out for the last couple of two or three years. But it's also looking at the world economy, we see that if we are looking at the ocean as an asset, economic asset, we know that it would be the seventh biggest world economy in the world if you're just looking at the renewables that the ocean are giving us, just between UK and Brazil on the list of world economies. But in a bigger picture, and even more important, people are often referring to the forest and the rainforest, in particular in the Amazons, as the world lungs that provides us with oxygen. But if we're diving into the ocean, that's actually the world lungs. Looking at the macroalgae and the microalgae, that actually provides us with the oxygen in 3 out of 4 breaths that we take every single day. And it's the heart of the lungs of the planet, but it's also the heart of the planet. We know that all the big circles of life, if you're looking at the water circle or the carbon circle, it starts in the ocean, ends up in the ocean. So we are really bad at taking too much out of the ocean, but at the same time, we're really bad at filling the ocean with stuff that shouldn't be there in the first place too, especially plastics. Over 8 million tons of it every year, and the amount is increasing. And this is Norwegian waters. This is not somewhere far off. This is Norwegian waters. But okay, going back to maybe we can have a sunrise instead. WWF, we launched an idea of a zero tolerance vision for plastic pollution in August 2017. Because we needed to have a global vision that we shouldn't have plastic in the ocean. And this got momentum not just nationally, but luckily also our Minister of Climate and Environment at the time, Vidar Helgesen, you met him earlier this week, he brought this first to our ocean conference and then all the way to the UNEA meeting, the UN Environment Assembly, in December the same year, and we got a resolution passed in that meeting that there's a global zero tolerance vision for plastic pollution. And we even got a bigger result last year. We were asking for a rescue package or a rescue mission for the ocean, tackling all the big things that the big threats that the ocean are facing, the temperature increase, ocean acidification, illegal fishing, marine pollution, and the loss of habitats and biodiversity. And September last year, we actually got that. We got a World Bank that announced a global fund that actually are supposed to tackle these issues. So now we just have to make sure that this fund actually are doing the job that they are doing, supposed to do, and make that fund work. Now we have a big global fund that we actually could have work. And that gives hope. Hope for those areas that also Silje Lundberg mentioned. Hope that we can take care of, for instance, the Lofoten Islands, have a plan to take care of them, and we can provide the biggest cod stock in the world, provide this mainland Europe's biggest seabird colony, and also the biggest coral reefs in the world, that we can provide them into the future and to these generations coming ahead. These are just a collection of some of my biggest heroes, and the biggest one is on the bottom to the right. That's my son. He's 6 years old now, and he raises his sister. She's also one of the heroes. He raises his sister now whenever they find plastic on the beach to pick it up, and that brings us back here. It's all about, is this a sunset or is this a sunrise? I believe that this is a sunrise. Why? Because we have the knowledge, and there's a component here. Humans are to blame. It's our fault, but we can also, since it's human-made, we can solve it. It only takes courage and will. And if not us, then who? If not now, then when? Thanks.
Thank you, Fredrik. Thank you to all of you who have been here this evening. Our journey has come to an end, and I have one last treat for you, one last presentation. As I promised in the introduction, there will be a Northern Lights show. And I hope you're ready for a Northern Lights show. To end our PechaKucha event, I'm proud to give the stage to Mr. Paul Brekke, who is a senior advisor at the Norwegian Space Center. So, Paul, take it away, and please give him a big round of applause.
Thank you. So I hope you're ready for some Northern Lights, both in here and outside.
And this is just a 10-minute summary on the story about Nordlight, particularly for those of you who never seen it or been to the North and experienced it. So I'm going to do a little bit of history and then what's actually causing it and then how we can predict the Nordlights a few days ahead. And that's what we have done the last 2 days for the conference. But if you go far back in time, and in particular the few times the Nordlight moved far south in Europe, people were mostly afraid of the Nordlights. There was a sign of God being angry, war, the disease going and breaking out, and so on. And so people didn't understand it at all. And the Sami people up in North Norway, they still call the Nordlight Gohofsahas, the light you can hear. And it's actually lots of people think they can hear like crackling sound, like you're folding aluminum foil when you hear strong Nordlights. And scientists don't really understand it because at the height of the Nordlight, it's a vacuum, so sound cannot really propagate from space down to ground, so there must be something else. And scientists still working on trying to understand that kind of dilemma. But again, in Nordic culture, the Nordlight was very often connected to dead spirits. And people thought the Nordlight was a way that the gods or the spirit was trying to connect with the people down here. In the Inuit people in Greenland, they thought it was a dead spirit having fun in the sky, dancing and playing soccer with a walrus skull. And even the Indians in North Dakota had stories about Nordlights. They thought it was the reflection on the sky from big fires where the enemies up far north was boiling their dead captured people. And in Finland, the name of the Nordlight is Revontula, which is the name of the Arctic fox running far north, and the first touching the mountains, and the snow is furled up in its ear and causing this reflection on the sky. In Denmark, there's a romantic conception that there was a throng of swans flying really far north, and they got stuck in the ice, and they were flapping their wings to try to get loose, and that was again creating this reflection on the sky. And even here in North Norway, not that far back in time, there was a story that you can actually wave with handkerchiefs and make the Nordlight get more intense. And some people also took their kids inside because the Nordlight was very often believed to steal children. So that was the kind of historical part far back in time. But it's actually Vikings that used the expression Northern Lights for the first time, Nordurjus. But you probably also know that the Northern Light has a scientific name called the Aurora Borealis. But maybe not many of you know who actually introduced that expression. Surprisingly, it was actually Galileo in Italy that used that expression. Like I said, the few times the Northern Light moves so far south, it's only the red part of the Northern Light is visible. So he called it the Dawn of the North because he saw this red sky. And that's been tricking people up through history, actually. Emperor Tiberius, he saw this red sky one time, and he sent his troop down to his river or ocean city and thought his city was captured by the enemies and put on fire. But all he saw was Northern Lights. But he sent his troop down there to save his harbor. And the first to understand Northern Light was actually Christian Birkeland, a Norwegian scientist. In 1896, he had a theory that space was not empty. It was full with particles coming from the sun, captured by the Northern Light, or the magnetic field of the Earth, channeled down towards the polar region and causing the Northern Lights. And nobody believed him, and he actually struggled a lot, in particular with a big scientist in the UK, Chapman and Lord Kelvin, and nobody believed him. So he decided to make an experiment to prove his own theory. And this is a famous Tyrrell experiment, where he has a glass box, vacuum chamber, put a metal sphere in there, which was the Earth, and magnet inside, and bombard this with electrons. He did actually this 3 years before we discovered the electron, surprisingly. So actually, he was actually the first to discover electrons. Actually, Chapman, now, anyway, so, but, well, not going to take that story, but he also saw that must be similar lights on the southern hemisphere. Still, nobody used his theories because the English school was still using the universities, even in Oslo, until the 1957, when a Russian satellite actually measured the solar wind for the first time. We could confirm that Birkeland was right all the time. But he was pictured on this Turing Crown bill in 1994, and the whole story is about the Northern Light here. You can see Big Dipper, the Northern Light behind his head, the pole star, ice crystal because you see the Northern Lights in the winter, the Tyrrell experiments. On the back side of the note, it's a map of the Arctic. You can see Norway, you can see the magnetic pole and the Northern Light oval, which goes around that magnetic pole. And if you are a nerd like me, having a UV flashlight in your pocket, you can actually check these bills and see if it's valid. It's a watermark connected to the person in all the Norwegian bills, and there is a comet in this one. And the reason is that Birkeland was the first in the world to actually explain the shape of the comet tails, again,
because of the solar wind. And so he was a great scientist, the first space scientist. He was nominated for Nobel Prize 8 times, but never actually got it. So in the anniversary year, in 2017, Norges Bank exchanged this bill with a codfish, amazingly. But they still have some northern lights on it, actually. It's this little oval there. I complained, actually. Then I got a phone call from Norges Bank after this Facebook message. So to understand the northern lights, we need to understand the sun. That's kind of the driver of the whole northern lights system. And the sun is really active. We don't see it really from ground, but from space, you can see it's really active. And we're living down there to the right. And sometimes the sun hurls a lot of gas out in space, and sometimes directed to us. Of course, the distance is not in scale here, of course. The distance is actually 150 million kilometers. But when these gas clouds come towards the Earth, at some point they will, after 2-3 days, they will then collide with our magnetosphere. And in particular, if they are opposite directed, these magnetic fields, you get a very strong connection. And some particles will channel down on the day side and make what they call the daytime aurora. We cannot see that at the daytime, but at Svalbard, you can actually see it in the dark time. But the nighttime aurora we see here, typically the green light, is caused by particles moving down on the far side of the sun and the magnetic field connecting together, and they are being ejected back towards the atmosphere of the Earth and the polar region. That's what's basically making the northern lights. And now you can ask, what's causing this atmosphere to glow? We tried to illustrate this with a nice animation. Now we're going to travel with these particles down towards the Earth and see what happens. So when then coming deeper down the atmosphere, the density increasing, and then they will start colliding with the atoms and molecules, in particular oxygen and nitrogen, these are two gases that are reacting. And when they collide, they transfer energy to each of those atoms in the atmosphere. And then these atoms will then start emitting light. And some will make red northern lights, some green and blue, typically red on the top and green in the middle and so on. And what happened, of course, in an atom is that when you transfer energy to an atom, you excite it. Then you move the atom's electron out to a different orbit. And the atom doesn't like to be at the excited state. The electron tries to get back, and to get back, you have to release energy. And you do that by sending out light on a certain frequency, depending on those energy levels. And that's what basically creating this beautiful oval around the the Arctic region. And you have to kind of be close to this oval to see the northern lights. So at the North Pole, you don't see that much. You have to be closer to the oval. Again, I mentioned the altitude. For about 80 kilometers up to 900 kilometers sometimes. So it's a space phenomenon, not a weather phenomenon. And if you really want to see the northern lights and be guaranteed, then you should go to the space station, because they see the northern lights every orbit, 2 times every orbit, actually. A beautiful sight that they're flying through the top of the northern lights, but you can see how it kind of starts on a certain level and stretching out in space. We do still do, of course, research on the northern lights, particularly here in North Norway, on their rocket range, Svalbard, Tromsø University, because the same processes that creating the northern lights will also interfere with our technology-based society. The solar storm can affect GPS, radio communication, power grid, and so on. That's why this science is still important. We call that space weather and space weather warning. And by using those satellites, we can monitor the sun 24 hours a day, and we can do very good forecasting of these solar storms and clouds of gas coming out. They tend to spend around 1 day to 3 days, depending on the speed. And by using the internet, you can, of course, then find lots of web pages that are giving you good forecasting for northern lights. And it's also lots of cell phone apps, of course, you can download. And make sure you don't go to bed too early when there's northern lights outside. That's an important thing. So I'm going to try to argue also, why is Norway the best country to go to see northern lights? Last time I gave a talk outside Norway was in Washington, D.C. at JGU. Then you are the latitude of Spain. And if you go to Oslo, you are the latitude of typically South Alaska, and up here in Tromsø, we are at the latitude of North Alaska, and at Svalbard, you are really far north. But typically, the northern lights are most active in this band you can see here. Of course, you can go to northern Alaska or northern Canada or Siberia or Greenland, but it's really hard to get there. There's very little infrastructure in most of the places. It's also very cold compared to Norway. So we have a lot of infrastructure here, easy access for tourism. So also Norway and Sweden and Finland, of course, north is also good, and Iceland. But Norway is really a nice place to see. So if you want to go out tonight and want to take pictures, it's also important that you, I think the most important thing you can bring you, except the camera, of course, is the tripod, because you usually need long exposure times. It's not very difficult to take pictures. And for those of you who know the ISO, turn up the ISO, wide angle lens is good. So that's basically what you need, but typically long exposures. And very often people want to take these kind of selfie pictures. That's also quite easy, just to put your friends up, a long exposure, 10 seconds, use your flashlight on the cell phone for a second up in their faces, and you get pictures like this. And even if they move a little bit, doesn't matter because they illuminate just for a short second. This is actually from Arctic Frontiers last year, from the top of the Edge Hotel. So even in the city, you can sometimes see the Northern Light. We can also see there's a lot of light pollution here in this video I took at the rooftop. But lots of our participants had never seen it before, so they've still had a great experience. And also for those who came from the United States, if you're flying from US to Europe, you're flying always far north. You should always make sure to have a left seat, window seat on the plane, because you will actually see the Northern Lights almost every flight, because you're flying over to Greenland. So don't sleep when you go next time. The picture to the right here is actually two pictures I took myself when I flew from Tromsø here. Also, it's nice if you're flying night flights down. You see the Northern Lights really going nice out the window of aircraft. So I'm going to end with a video now, and I'm going to just give you the forecast after this video. But this is a time-lapse photography and some real-time photography from a documentary we have made. It's taken by Ørjan Bertelsen. He lives up here, and it gives you kind of a feeling for what you can see, in particular if you go to a dark spot and using a camera. Also, of course, all the movements you see in Northern Lights is actually the Earth's magnetic field being buffeted by the solar wind gust, actually. So that's what you're seeing. You also actually see compass needle also varying during this Northern Lights. So what's the forecast for tonight? This is the forecast that's made by having satellites sitting just outside the magnetosphere, measuring the wind speed, just like a wind measurement in the ocean. And then we can determine when the speed goes up, we know that 50 minutes later or something, it will buffet our magnetosphere and we'll get the map that reacts. And the forecast is actually, like you see on the map here, it will be quite strong, apparently. And you can see the Northern Lights all the way into that green line. You can still see the Northern Lights in the horizon. So almost down to Denmark, they predict that the Northern Light will reach. And the same will be actually for tomorrow and also a little bit less on that will be Friday. So the week is really good. Of course, the most important thing is, of course, the weather. And that looks good too, also for the next few days. So it looks really good for you if you want to go out. Of course, it's important to get out of the dark spot. Typically, along the harbor right here, there's so many fishing boats and the hurtigruten and lights. So that will illuminate.